in Mumbai. I am Advocate Nisha Lotia, and we will study about the legal aptitude for your law entrance exam. And my today's topic will be about the Contract Act. The Indian Contract Act, 1872, it was enacted by the Parliament of India, and it is a very old law, and it is taken from the British law. So the language will be of theirs, and there are lots of Latin phrases used, and which will I'll explain as and when it is required. So, and they can be one of the important part in your paper also, because in recent papers they had asked 5 to 6 legal phrases. They are called as legal maxims in for the Contract Act. So please do not ignore it. And as and when required, I will explain you the Latin words. Now, this is the Indian Contract Act, 1872, and it is accepted by, you know, it is implied in the all of states of India except the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Now, we will go to the contract. Now, what is contract? It is very important to understand the concept of contract, as the whole Contract Act is based on the topic of contract only. So contract is very important, and it has to be understood in a right sense. So contract is defined as an agreement enforceable before the law. So we will, to understand it better, we will split it into two parts: an agreement, and which is enforceable before law. Enforceable means there is an obligation between the parties to fulfill it, or it is legally binding. It is legally binding. So when there is an agreement which is legally binding, it becomes a contract. An agreement which is of social and religious nature, which is of social or religious nature, will not be legally binding. For example, if A tells to B that let's go out for a dinner, and B says, okay, I will be there. So it is an agreement which is of a social nature. So in this case, if B does not turn up due to some reason, A cannot go to the court of law and say that I want to sue my friend because he or she promised me and has not come for the dinner. Court will say that it is not a legally binding document. When an agreement is legally binding, then only it comes into the category of a contract. So contract is agreement plus legal enforceability, means there is a legal obligation, there is a legal binding. Now, a simple example can be over here. A tells to B, I will sell you 500 bags of wheat, 500 bags for rupees 10,000. It is a perfect agreement which can be resulted into a contract, because the deal for 500 bags for rupees 10,000 is perfectly valid for the category of a contract, and it can be enforceable by law. In the sense, if any of the parties does not do his duty, then the other can go to the court of law and, you know, make him compulsory do it with the help of the law. So a contract is agreement plus legal enforceability. So it is a very, very interesting statement over here that all agreements are contracts. However, all contracts are not agreements. For a contract to be there, there has to be an agreement. So we can say that an agreement is mother and a contract is a child. So first of all, there has to be a mother. and then only there will be a child. So all agreements are contract, however all contracts are not agreement. Okay, so there can not be any contract without an agreement. So agreement has to be there first. So all agreement necessarily cannot be contracts. Okay, I think I'm clear over here. Now we go to another topic over here of an agreement. Now what is an agreement? An agreement is a promise or every set of promises forming consideration for each other. Now for example, A tells to B, I will sell you 1,000 pieces of radios. B says, okay, I will buy them for rupees 1 lakh. So there is a set of promises, there is a set of promise of buying and selling of radios for consideration of 1 lakh rupees. Buying and selling of radios for 1 lakh rupees. So it is a agreement between two parties. It is an agreement between the two parties. So they mutually agree to do it and they make an agreement. So we can understand this in a better way, where we say we'll split still the definition of agreement into the two parts. So it is a promise. As I said earlier, what is an agreement is a promise, a set of promises. So we will understand in detail what is promise. According to section 2B, promise or acceptance provides that when a person to whom proposal or offer is made, in the sense when A tells to B that I will sell you the radio for 1 lakh rupees. So this is the offer or proposal. And B says, okay, I will buy your 10,000 radios or 1,000 radios. So this is the acceptance. When a person to whom offer or proposal is made signifies his assent, means is accepted thereto, the proposal is said to be accepted. A proposal when accepted becomes a promise, and when it becomes a promise, it automatically becomes an agreement. So when A sells radio for 1 lakh rupees, A tells I want to sell my radio for 1 lakh rupees, it is his offer. And when B says I'll buy your 1,000 radio, it is the acceptance. So offer plus acceptance, as I said here rightly it is written, offer plus acceptance becomes an agreement. These are very important points for the examination point of view, because lots of questions are based on these topics for around 4 to 5 marks we expect from the topic of contract. So like proposal, offer, consideration and agreement, contract, all these are very important terms and very important topics for your examination point of view. I will discuss with you the latest papers also, which the questions coming from there also. So you will have a better idea of actually what type of questions are asked in the exams and how you have to crack it. Now, offer and proposal. What is an offer or proposal? Okay. When one person signifies to another his willingness to do or abstain from doing, what does abstain from doing? From, he does not want to do. Does not want to do. From doing anything. With a view to obtaining the assent. With a view to obtaining the assent means with a view to obtaining an answer of that other person, either to such act or abstinence, he is said to make a proposal. A says to B, let's go for a dinner. Let's go for a dinner. In this case, A is making a proposal for going to dinner to B. Now when B says, okay, I will reach by 9 o'clock, he accepted it. Okay, so these words means only these things, like when one person signifies to another his willingness to do or to abstain from doing anything, matlab he expresses his willingness that we'll go for a dinner with a view, matlab he wants the answer of that another person to such an act or abstinence, he is said to make a proposal. So when B is asking for a dinner, he is said to make a proposal. Now see, all the points in law, like all the topics like offer, acceptance, agreement, consideration, minor, capacity, everything will be having two things, like essentials and exceptions. Essentials is there has to be all these points whereby the definition which are there in the definition, then only a particular term will be applied, like for an offer. So there has to be these essentials to be present, then only it will apply to the term of the offer. Same way there are some exceptions, which if these points are not there in certain cases, then also they fall into the category of an offer and proposal. And in exam, and in from examination point of view, questions, there are most chances that the questions will be based on the exceptions and essentials. So you don't have to actually mug up the definition, but you have to just understand them, just understand the definition, because principle will already be given in your papers, and you have to only write your answer on the basis of the facts which are mentioned in the paper. So you have to understand the concepts very well, and you have to remember the essentials and exceptions of all the topics. So the first essential of the offer is that it may be expressed or implied. The other party has somehow know about the proposal. A person cannot talk to himself. He has to convey his expression. He has to convey his wish that I want to do this. It must be certain or not vague. In the sense, a lover cannot promise. If a lover promises that, I will get stars for you, then it is not an offer, because it is vague, It actually cannot be done. In the capable of legal obligation, it has to be capable of a legal obligation. There has, I'll give you one good example over here. If a priest will say that, give me 1 lakh rupees and I will pray that you will get a better job. Now, is this offer a valid offer? No, because it does not give rise to a legal obligation. If tomorrow you pay him, you pay the priest, and you do not get a good job, can you go to the court of law? No. So it is not capable of creating a legal obligation. Now same, it must be communicated to the party in the right sense. You don't have to, keep it to yourself. But if A wants to deal with B, he cannot communicate to C. He cannot communicate it to C. He has to communicate to it B only, unless there are exceptions to this rule. Whether if C is an agent of A, yes, he can communicate. Okay, I will discuss this later. But there was one of the questions from the recent papers where he said that A communicated to B that I will buy your flat, and B gave his assent through C, who was an appointed agent to A. Now is this offer a valid offer, or is this acceptance a valid acceptance? The answer was yes, because C is an authorized person, because he is an appointed agent of B. So these statements, these examples, these essentials and exceptions are very much important when it comes to examination point of view. Now one more question I'll discuss with the recent papers, where a person makes a statement in an uninhabited hall that he wants to sell his car. What does uninhabited hall means? Means there is no one in the hall. there is no one in the hall, no one present. In an empty hall, if somebody yells and tells that, you know, I want to sell my car. Now the question was, does this statement amount to proposal, promise or agreement? The answer was that it does not amount to any of these things because he has not communicated it to the other party. He has just made a statement in an uninhabited hall. There was nobody to listen to it. So it is not come. There are no two parties. It is not communicated to anybody. So these types of questions you can expect in the paper. Okay? I hope I'm clear. Thank you for listening peacefully and patiently to my lectures. We'll see you soon with many other topics.